got a dead mic. No, there we go. All right, Mike just came to me a few seconds ago and said, okay, you're up next because I need somebody to fill in the time, but I've got plenty of stuff to share with you. So I've been doing seminars all over the world for the last 20 years. I've spoken about 20 different countries. I've done over 100 presentations for the PGA, for the Club Managers Association, for the UK PGA. And every time I'm in a seminar, I ask, what business do you think you're in? And almost every time the answers are, we're in the golf business, we're in the people business, we're in the service business, we're in the club business. Well, as many people have talked about today, the real business we are in and always was is the entertainment business. And so I've got three important points that I want to stress in this presentation. Number one is just think about all the different ways you can entertain your members and guests. So that's number one. Number two is that you have to create Kodak moments. And the way everybody's talking about the digital, everything going digital, totally right. Everything's going digital. But a lot of people are not taking advantage of the fact that everybody is digital. Everybody is taking pictures of their breakfast. Everybody is taking pictures of funny signs. Everybody is taking pictures of things that they want to share on Facebook, on Instagram, on TikTok. And if you will think about how you can enhance that, make it easy for your customers to find a reason at every single touch point of your business to take a picture and tag Wilson, take a picture and tag TaylorMade, take a picture and tag Hoy An Shores or Sensoza. You've got to give them reasons to turn your guests into a marketing army. So whether you like it or not, we are in the entertainment business. And everywhere you look, your competition is not just the golf club down the street. It's not just Top Gun. It's Formula One. It's floating across the desert in a hot air balloon. It's experiencing flying a MiG fighter. Every single thing that is entertainment is your enemy because it's taking away dollars that could be spent at your course. So 5 years ago in Da Nang, when I first, actually the second time I spoke, I talked about a thing called the One Strategy. And the One Strategy is to make one thing at every touch point in your business so exceptional, so amazing, that every single one of your guests is going to want to take a picture of it and share it on social media. We're living in an experience economy. If you go to Orlando, Rainforest Cafe, Planet Hollywood, Margaritaville. If you go to Vegas, every hotel is themed. You've got the Parisian, the Monte Carlo, the New York, the Palazzo, the Venetian. Everything is themed. Everything in Vegas is set up to enhance the experience of a hotel room with a bed. And that's what you got to look to do in your golf business. Back in the 70s, the Kodak Film Company came up with a wonderful campaign, one of the best advertising campaigns in history, of creating Kodak moments, of moments you wanted to capture and share. And it's never been easier to capture and share. So this is going back about 10 years when I first came up with the idea for the One Strategy. And I was playing golf somewhere in England, Dale Hill Golf Club. I was taking a lesson. And at the end of the day, I offered to buy the pro dinner because he wouldn't accept payment from me. And he took me to a little pub. And we went to this pub, the Bell Inn. It's a typical little English pub. It's got a small restaurant. And about after we had dinner, I left, went to Spain and Portugal for 2 months, came back, took another lesson, agreed to buy him dinner again. And he said, well, let's go to such and such a place. And I go, well, is that the place we went last time? And he said, well, where did we go? I go, well, I don't remember. It was dark, country roads. It was some pub nearby. And he goes, well, what was it called? I go, I don't remember what it was called, but it was the pub with the cool toilets. And the men's room at the Bell Hotel has French horns to pee in. Now, I know it's a little weird, but how many people in here would take a picture of that if they saw it? Put your hands up. It's okay. It's okay. We won't think you're weird. And I did, and I took a picture of it, and I shared it all over social media, and I thought, this is crazy. And then a few weeks later, I was in Vegas. I was in the Las Vegas Hilton in their sports bar, and this was the restroom in the sports bar of the Las Vegas Hilton. So once again, I took a picture. Then I was in a restaurant in New York City. Now you're probably thinking, this guy's pretty weird. He's got a toilet fetish. But the point is, think about this. If you can get people to take a picture of your restroom and promote your business because your restrooms are cool, how much easier is it with your beautiful golf course, with your wonderful clubhouse, with your amazing pro shop? And that's what we're going to talk about. So I was in Switzerland, and this is the restroom on the golf course in Switzerland. I took a picture. I tagged it, Gams Country Club. Hey, this is pretty cool. This was in France, you know, and it's nothing exceptional, but instead of saying men's and women's, they got a picture of Nancy Lopez and a picture of Jack. I thought it was cool. How do you know I thought it was cool? Because I got a damn picture of it and shared it all over social media. That's how you know it's cool. Okay, so this is Etretat. Great golf course an hour's drive south of Calais. I played there this year. Now, if you have a golf course that looks like this, you don't really need to do that much, right? You don't really need to invent everything because it's so cool just the way it is. It's actually not a very good golf course. It's actually pretty boring, pretty flat. But the pictures you can take there are amazing. And the same is true at Royal St. David's. I mean, this is Game of Thrones golf. You see the castle on every hole. You don't need to create anything. You just need everybody taking pictures of the castle. You know, you expect a Lannister to show up on the first tee. We all know that hole. Who knows where that is? What hole is it? The seventh, correct. Anybody know where that is? Where's my Jack Nicklaus people? So I'm really lucky is that I've played almost all the world's best courses. I haven't played Augusta, so if anybody can get me on there, let me know. But I have been lucky enough to play 101 rounds at the world's number one golf course, which is Pine Valley. But this is my favorite golf course in the world. It's a Jack Nicklaus course in Punta Espada is the name of the course in the Dominican Republic. Absolutely stunning. You don't need to create much. But let's look at Augusta. Everybody knows about Amen Corner. Not every hole at Augusta is great. There's some holes at Augusta that look fairly average. But they've done an amazing job, especially on TV, of focusing in on Amen Corner, which was a term coined up by the sports writer Herbert Warren Wind many, many years ago. Now, you may not have a spectacular golf course like the ones I've just shown you. In that case, what you can do to help with your marketing, to help with your branding, to help with sharing your story on social media is create three holes. So this is the Bear Trap down in West Palm Beach. Or at Innisbrook, they've got three or four holes that is the Talon. Talon's Grip is at Stony Brook. Sorry, that was the Viper Pit at Innisbrook. So this is an amazing golf course. This is a very average golf course in Orlando, but they increase their brand, they increase the excitement, they talk about these four holes they have, and they focus in on that, and they brand the four holes, because the rest of the golf course isn't that exciting. But by branding those four holes, they increase the value of your round, and people talk about, oh, how did you play, you know, in that particular section. All right, maybe you don't even have three good holes. Maybe all you need is one great hole, and we all know where that is. But there are other holes out there where the whole DNA of the course boils down to a single hole. This one is in Washington, which is, you may or may not know, is the Apple capital of America. And again, it's a very ordinary golf course, except for one hole. And if you played that hole, who would take a picture of that hole? Okay, everybody. This one sadly is no longer with us, but this was the Jason and the Argonauts hole at Stone something in New Jersey. Guess why it's no longer with us? And it isn't because people didn't take pictures of it. It was just too damn hard. Okay, this is the hole I've played. And again, this whole resort was branded by one hole. It's the world's only 440-yard par three. And to get to the tee, you take a helicopter up to the top. It's the only way to get there. It's actually 1 mile. It's like a mile up. And from there, you can hit driver down at that. There's me hitting driver down there. And it was a pretty cool experience. And every single person who played that hole put it on social media, tagged the course. We were their marketing army. And I guarantee you that every single person who plays that one hole promotes the course for you. All right, here's some questions. What are some other places where maybe you don't even have one hole? That is the bunker at, guess what the name of the golf course is? Green Monkey, right. Once again, I mean, it's not that hard to do that, to make your bunker, to put something in your bunker, some kind of art, some kind of grass, and create something that your players will take pictures of, tag it on social media, and promote your course for free. If you're filling up your tee sheet every day, you've got 140 players, maybe even 280 players a day that can be promoting your course, but you've got to give them reasons. Guess where that is? Orlando, the land of the mouse, okay? And again, you're probably going to take a picture of that. How about that one? This one is somewhere in China. And that is pretty innovative stuff right there. And once again, I mean, you could take the most boring course in the world, some flat, you know, dog track in Orlando, which sums up a lot of them in Orlando, to be fair. But, you know, you could do something like that, and all of a sudden you take this flat dog track and turn it into a tourist attraction. So I put that on social media when I found it. And I mean, this is without promoting it. You know, almost, you know, 4,500 people looked at that because it's cool. This one's in Minnesota, and it's called, I can't remember, Thunderfoot or Bigfoot or something like that. But again, how simple is that to create a feature on your course? We're not talking about course redesigns here. We're not talking about spending thousands and thousands of dollars. We're just talking about making sure you do something that people want to shoot and share. This one's down in, that is in Mexico, Ibero Star Resort, and the actual green is the shape of the company's logo, which is pretty cool. This one, I forget where this one is, but it's a flower of some kind. This is actually real. It doesn't look real, but it's actually a real bunker at a golf course in Portugal. And here we've got the church pews at Oakmont. Again, I think that if most people were lucky enough to play at Oakmont, they're going to take a picture of the church pew bunkers because, one, they're pretty cool unless you're in them, and two, it's very shareable stuff. That is the 6th or 7th at Riviera. They have a bunker in the middle of the green. I think it's a little goofy. They also have one at Doonbeg. But I guarantee you that if you play a golf course where there's a bunker in the middle of the green, people are going to be taking pictures of it. People are going to be sharing comments, although they may not all be positive. Okay, maybe your feature is a wall. This one is at North Berwick. in Scotland. There's the very famous road that is a feature that people take pictures of the road because it is an icon of that particular hole, the 17th. This is one I found this year in France at a golf course called Wimereux. Does anybody know what that is? It's a coastal defense from World War II. They call them pillboxes in England. I don't know what the French name for them is, but the T for that par three is on top of the pillbox, which again is very photo friendly. This one is at up in the Hudson National Golf Club in New York. Wonderful golf course, about 30 or 40 miles outside Manhattan. And it's just kind of a remnant of a building that was there. It's no specific significance, but it's just kind of there. They never took it away, and it's kind of unusual. And, you know, everybody in my group took a photo there. There's, that's the old head, I can't remember what they call those things, the Islam's, some ancient monument at Old Head in Ireland. And again, very photo friendly. This one is the National Golf Links. And again, a windmill. That's pretty unusual on a golf course. And what do? We all took photos of the windmill and tagged the golf course. We were their marketing army. Maybe your thing is a bridge. I mean, look at it. It's not much of a bridge, is it? Really? I mean, we've all seen better bridges. But I guarantee you, if you walk over that bridge, this is what happens next. So maybe you could turn your bridge, whatever bridge you have, onto a golf course. I mean, that looks like the bridges of Madison County. You know? You can turn your bridge into some kind of icon that gets people engaged, that gets people doing your job for you of promoting. Maybe it's your status hut. This is the status hut at Royal St. George's, which is the course next to my club in England, which is my overseas club. By the way, that club has that wedge you just showed. It's Prince's. And I have had that wedge in my hands and have a picture to prove it. Yes, it is. And there's a good chance the Open may go back there. 2032, the centenary. So you might want to book your accommodation there now. I got three properties there. Wilson can have them all for the week. 10 grand a week. Here's another starter's hut. There's one at Thai Country Club. Again, it was just you could go up there and stand there. And I did. Okay. Maybe all of these things are a little too hard for you to do, or maybe you think they cost too much money, or maybe they're too difficult. That's your typical tee marker. Nobody's going to take a picture of it. This one, they might take a picture of. Simple little change, put some cool tee markers out there. These are ones from Banyan, where they have pineapples. That is Congressional Country Club in Washington, D.C. Looks like the Capitol building. Can't remember where that is, but it was photo worthy for me. That one was cool. Somewhere in Texas, obviously. Dragon. Flowers. This is PJ Catalana in Spain. I think it's arguably, it's definitely better than Valderrama. I really think it's the best golf course in Spain. They got 36 holes, unbelievable golf course, the championship course. There's a very good chance they'll get the next Ryder Cup. There's only two in the short list, and they're one of them. And they just have amazing flowers. This one's up in Michigan, Treetops Resort. This one, the next one is in Wisconsin. Flowers. That's real. That's a real hole. A golf club in Wisconsin. Do you think you'd take a picture of that hole? Sure you would. Augusta National, they're in on the flower thing too, look. Now, this is my favorite thing. There is no better investment for your golf club than a statue. Put up a statue of your architect. Put up a statue of Jack Nicklaus. Put up a statue of Arnie. I had a golf club up in Wisconsin called Golf the Bull. It was the only Jack Nicklaus golf course in Wisconsin. The only one. Hell of a good golf course. It did have a couple of problems though. Number one, it was in a town called Sheboygan, which only has a population of 4,000. That's number one problem. Number two, it's 100 miles from Milwaukee where all the people live. That's number two problem. The number three problem was, despite the fact that it was the only Jack Nicklaus golf course in Wisconsin, it was the fifth best course in town. No disrespect to our Jack Nicklaus people, but it was right next to a thing called Black Wolf Run and right next to a thing called Whistling Straits, 2 miles away. And so despite the fact that it was a great golf course, they were struggling like hell. So they had hired me to do the marketing. And the first, it was called Golf the Bull. It was built on an old bull farm, and it was a part residential development, but the residential development was done. And so I talked to the guy, Dave, and it's like, what's the first thing we should do? I said, the first thing we should do is buy a bull. He's like, why are we going to buy a bull, Andrew? Because we're going to take the bull. What's the signature hole? I think the signature hole was number six. I go, we're going to take the bull, and we're going to put it on number six. And he's like, well, where am I going to get a bull from? I go, you're going to Google it. So we Google it. And you can buy a life-size bull for $1,200. $1,200, life-size bull. He goes, well, what about the shipping cost, Andrew? You know, you got a $7 million golf course that's losing its ass, and he's worried about spending, this is what I deal with. And he's worried about spending 200 lousy bucks on shipping the bull. And the whole time I worked for him, I'm like, Dave, please buy a bull. And we'll put the bull out on the tee. And every single guy that goes past the 6th tee will climb on the bull and take pictures of the bull and the hole and your Jack Nicklaus golf course. And they'll tag it. And people in Wisconsin and in Milwaukee and in Green Bay will see how much fun guys have when they go play the bull. Sadly, he didn't buy a bull. And I wanted him to buy three more bulls. I wanted him to put bulls out on the range. I wanted a 150 bull, a 175 bull, and a 200-yard bull. He thought it was bull. People love statues. Best thing you can possibly do. There's Jack somewhere in Ireland. Lahinch. Anybody play Lahinch in Ireland? Anybody? The only thing missing from that golf course is windmills. Okay? That's a crazy golf course. But you put out a picture of, you put out a statue of a goat. Look, this is a goat. This isn't even a person, right? It's a goat. But look at this. They love the goat. Let's put a picture of Tom Brady there. Go Tampa Bay Bucks. Okay, there is the Payne Stewart statue. Anybody know where that is? Nobody. Okay, guys got to get to Ireland more often. That is the Payne Stewart statue. No? Yeah, it's in Ireland. Here we go. Waterville. There you go. If you put a statue of a golfer up, golfers will stand next to the statue and take pictures. We all know where that one is, right? Some of us know where that one is, right? Pinehurst, okay? Boom, look. Even famous people take pictures of themselves with a statue. And they share them, not just on Facebook, not just on Twitter, not just on TikTok. You see them all the time on LinkedIn. I'm in 23 different golf groups on LinkedIn. And I post on LinkedIn pretty much every day. I reach 250 150,000 golfers on LinkedIn with my posts. You've heard of influencers, right? Well, nobody's ever paid me to influence, but a large corporation in America recently paid me several hundred thousand dollars just to shut up. How good is that? It's the best gig I ever had in my life. All I have to do is stop talking. I got paid several hundred thousand dollars just to shut it up. Why? Because I have a very big network online. So if I get some of these posts are going to all my 23 golf groups on LinkedIn, and they're going to my 40 golf groups on Facebook, between my different groups, I'm reaching 2 or 3 million people with my posts. Now imagine you did that with everybody who comes to your club. Arnie statue, that's Trey Lee. Who doesn't want that picture with Arnie? Everybody. This is in Carlsbad. This is the Crossings Municipal Course in Carlsbad. These two robot guys, they were in Portugal. Nice course north of Faro. Ah, Pete Dye. This is in Indiana at French Lick. That was somewhere in New Jersey. Oh, this one's good, down in Mexico. They've got every single hole on the golf course. They have a picture of a famous Mexican, like a statue of a famous Mexican. You know, like Pancho Villa, Speedy Gonzalez, all those people. This was at a range, just a random picture at a range. You know, if you went to hit balls at a range, would you take a picture of that and share it? I think most of you would. Thai Country Club. I know, this is Siam Country Club. Now, I have no idea why, what connection Spider-Man has to Siam Country Club. If any of you guys in Thailand know, let me know, because I never figured it out. But it's still picture-worthy. Beautiful golf course. They hold the Thai Open there and the Thai Ladies Championship there, and Spider-Man's climbing up the clubhouse wall. That is at Isleworth, or is that Nona or Isleworth? I forget. It's either Nona or Isleworth, high-end golf course in Orlando. Now, if you want to go whole hog, there's a golf course in New Zealand that has, look at life-size statues all over the golf course. All over the golf course. How cool is that? Turning your golf course into a work of art. Now that's a little overkill on the last. He's got 100 life-size wolves. 100. Now let's just dial it back a little. Simple things can get people to share their experience, to enhance their experience and share it with their friends. Anybody know where that is? Anybody? Tim, you know where that is, don't you? Huh? Marion. Now, Marion, anybody seen this picture? That is a very, very famous picture of Ben Hogan hitting a one iron to the last hole at Marion when he won the US Open there back in the 50s. And there's a plaque on the ground, 1950. Just to show you how much equipment's changed. I hit 8-iron from there. All right, it was downwind, but still. I mean, equipment has really changed, believe me. But you know, you see that in the middle of the fairway. It doesn't cost anything to enhance your history, to talk about your history, to relive something famous. And it doesn't have to be as famous as the US Open. It could just be, you know, this is where the club champion at your club hold a three wood. This is where the club champion or the ladies champion, you know, hold a two iron. Boom. 1967, I think that's a Baltusrol. Baltusrol on the 17th. It's photo worthy, it's shareable, and all it is a lousy $50 plaque. You've all got things that happened at your club that you can champion, that you can turn into a story. You know, great brands are built on great stories, like, you know, the story Tim just shared. I mean, it's a great story. It's a brand with huge history, huge moments. You've got to take those moments that happened at your club, the history of your club. Great players, celebrities, pros, or amateurs, and champion that. This is kind of funny, but this particular shot, I mean, this wasn't some shot like Watson chipping in. This was actually Arnold Palmer hacking it out of a bush. You could, that actually, all he did was hack it out of a bush. It didn't really go anywhere. He just didn't go on the green. He didn't make birdie. He just hacked it out of a bush that nobody thought he could hack it out of. Inverary Classic, 5 birdies in a row to win. Condo Canyon. Not everywhere I play is a 5-star course. So there's a pretty average sign. You know, nobody's going to take a picture of that because there's no reason to take a picture of that. It doesn't enhance my day by taking a picture of that. But if I put old Tom Morris's picture on it, and that makes it a little more worthy. If I have some friends that are into golf course architecture, and maybe I'm going to take a picture of that and send it to him. This one is at Omaha Beach Golf Club. Let me tell you how clever those frogs are. Omaha Beach Golf Club is nowhere near Omaha Beach. It's a good 30-minute, 40-minute drive away, but everybody knows about Omaha Beach because that's where all the troops landed on D-Day. And so they call the golf course Omaha Beach, and they champion the people that were involved in D-Day with a little history, and they incorporate that in. And the ground where the golf course is was certainly involved in heavy fighting and involved in the D-Day landings. But actually, Omaha Beach is 30 miles away. But they've taken that, adopted the name, put in a little history, and it's a great place to go play golf if you're on the French coast. Anything you can do to enhance the experience. Those are friends of mine in Canada, Ranson and his wife, and they sent me that picture. That's not a picture I took. They're sharing that picture with me on Facebook and tagging me because they know I like interesting pictures. This was a good idea. This is just a little random in there. You know, we all hate slow play, or hopefully we all hate slow play. My ideal round of golf, I think the best round of golf I ever had was probably about 15 years ago when I could still play. It was a 5-hour round. I shot 71-71 and had lunch. That was a good day. In 5 hours, 71-71 and had lunch. So, this, as of course, I forget where it was, but they had behind every tee, they had a little artificial putting green. So that way, if you're waiting on the tee, it doesn't seem like a wait because on every hole, you can have a little side game on the putting green. And I mean, if you've got a slow play problem, if you've got a high volume course, if you're doing 4.5-hour rounds, 5-hour rounds, shoot me now. But one way to take away the pain of waiting is to have this type of thing on back of the tee. I thought it was kind of a genius move because you can just play a separate game every tee you have to wait on the putting green. Very boring marker. Nobody's going to take a picture of that. Find them on every golf course. That's a little better, you know? You're waiting for some guy to hit, you know, he's waiting for the group in front. He thinks he can clear the water. We've all played with those guys, you know. His average shot goes 210, but he's going to hit this one 250 over water. Yeah. I mean, this doesn't take much. This doesn't cost money. This is a great way to enhance the experience, to get a chuckle, to make people laugh, and to get people taking pictures. Get it? Hey, how many times have you wanted to say that to someone? Hey. Flags. Everybody has flags. That's a pretty boring flag. Most of the flags you come across are boring. That one's not so boring. Everybody wants a picture next to that flag. That one's not bad. That one I like. Where's my Nicholas people? You can pay me later. Good old St. George killed a dragon. He's the patron saint in England. He's from Libya. Go figure. Goes from Libya. Patron saint of England goes from Libya. But anyway, that's our flag. It's a US flag. That is Loch Lomond in Scotland. And there's a club down in Florida, in Sarasota, which I've been fortunate enough to play a couple of times. Really nice course, very unpolitically correct. Very unpolitically correct. They don't allow women. It's a men's club. And their logo is very unpolitically correct. But what I like about the club is their rules. And when I went there as a guest, as a good host should, he took me into the locker room, which is fairly modest, and pointed to the rules on the wall so that I, as a guest, knew what I could and couldn't do without any fear of embarrassment. The first rule was allow faster players to play through. Great. The second rule was don't piss off the balcony. And he said, when I joined, there was only one rule. Anyway, that's Gator Creek's logo, and that's their flag. Very unpolitically correct. But very photo friendly. That is the baskets at Merion. They don't have flags. Again, you take a picture because it's unusual. Let's talk about signage. Golf clubs love signs, and I hate signs. Now, the only way I can tell you this story is because we're in Asia and it probably won't get back to anybody. Because I was a guest here, and when I'm a guest, I don't like to say negative things about the course. I only want to say positive things about the course. But this course happened to be one owned by the PGA. And instead of having arrows telling you where to go or where not to go, there were 100, and I'm not exaggerating because I counted, 177 signs like that one. Like when you came off a car path, it was no, 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 no. You can't make this shit up. Okay, 177 no's all the way around the golf course. No, no, no. I'm just like, really? Crazy. So there's a typical sign, typical golf course, you know. Corporate speak. I hate corporate speak. You know, corporate speak. Far more entertaining way to accomplish the same thing, right? This was in France. I thought this was cool. This was a Wimereux golf course. I've no idea what it says. Rendezvous, the pitches, I guess, repair your pitch mark. Where's Jean-Pierre? In here? Jean-Pierre, what does it say? Oh, there you go. Transitions below. Yeah, thank you. All right, it was cool. I mean, I thought it was a cool way, instead of the usual repair your pitch marks, boring, not exciting, they had these little funny cartoons, and I think it's a better way to get the message across than constantly preaching at people or saying, no, 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 no. I like that one. I used to have a group come down when I was at Black Diamond Ranch. I had a group come down every year from Connecticut, and I used to give out the Wounded Snail Award to the slowest player. Keep it fun. Make it photo worthy. That's telling them. Florida course. Disney course. And, you know, you can use your signage. By the way, if any of you are sticking around, there's a golf course about an hour north of Da Nang, which is an absolutely phenomenal course. It's called Laguna Lang, or whatever it's called, Laguna. Yeah, Laguna Lang. Really great golf course. And it's a Faldo course, but it starts off like a few holes go through the rice paddies. Then it goes into the jungle. Then it goes to the ocean, then it comes back into the jungle, back into the rice paddies, and back to the ocean. And it sounds like kind of a weird concept, but this is a phenomenal piece of property, really, really good strategic golf course. It's about an hour north. If you're sticking around, I highly recommend it. But, you know, they give you something, a reason to pose. And we were down in Panama at this high-end Marriott resort. It had signs all over the resort telling you where to take a selfie. Hey, stand up, stand in, take a selfie. But you know, a lot of the time you need to tell people what you want them to do. They made it easy. Stand here, take a picture of the big tree behind you. This was Bali National. I was fortunate enough to go there after one of the conventions a couple of years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago. Wonderful place. And you know, again, it's promoting the resort, and it's photo friendly. Here's one from when we had the events. Wahin was what, 6 years ago, Mike? Something like that. Another great place to play golf, both Black Mountain in Wahin. There used to be another good course there too. Copperhead, using plants to promote the brand. That's Glen Eagles. Actually, my parents live about 20 miles from Glen Eagles. And it's really funny when they had when they ride a cup there, it's like there was, the locals weren't happy with the Ryder Cup being on a new course. They wanted it on the old course, which obviously was too short. Signage. Sign like that can get people. So this is talking about how you can use your history and work your history into the photos. So there we go. Mr. Sarazen with the bunker, the Sarazen bunker, which is on the ninth of the Himalayas. There's my friend Michael Jones, and he did actually hit it quite close from there. But this is a great combination of storytelling, one strategy, and enhancing the experience. So Laddie Lucas was born in the clubhouse. His father was the clubhouse manager, and he was a very good left-handed player, played Walker Cup golf, very, very good player. And during the war, he was a squadron leader, Spitfire pilot. And when he was over France on a raid, his plane was hit, and one of the engines was on fire, and he was trying to get back to his base, and he couldn't quite make it. So what he did was, as soon as he saw land, he landed on the fourth hole of the golf course. And so there we have today a propeller next to the fourth tee commemorating Laddie Lucas landing on the fourth hole with his damaged Spitfire. But it gets better. He got out of his plane, ran 5 miles to the airport, and went back up again. They don't make them like that anymore. Let's look at golf carts. You play anywhere in the world, you're going to get a white club car or a white EasyGo or a white Yamaha, or maybe some places it's green, maybe some places it's blue, but for the most part they're white or cream, and give or take, they're all about the same. Nobody's taking pictures of your golf carts, but if you put something on them, maybe they take a picture. You can put on a decal set very, very inexpensively, and you can turn your golf cart into something more fun. Well, okay, you're not going to do that if you're Pine Valley, but you might do it if you're a daily fee golf course. You might do it if you're a resort golf course where having fun is really part of the deal. Boring, not so boring. Boring, not so boring, especially if you're a Canadian, eh? Any Canadians here? No. One? One in the back? Good man. Hey? Boring? Not boring. Not boring. Now think about this for a minute. That's a premium golf cart. You're going to have to pay more money to get a golf cart that looks like that. But probably not a lot more money. It's just casing. You know, it's fiberglass. I mean, maybe it's an extra grand, extra 2 grand. But maybe you could get an extra $10 for people that hired that cart. Maybe there's a $20 golf cart, a $30 golf cart, and a $40 golf cart. Guys on vacation might want the $40 golf cart. They might just want the picture. Maybe it's a $50 golf cart. Why don't you have a choice of golf carts? Why is everybody going to get the same lousy, you know, white golf carts? Why not give them a choice? Enhance the experience, give them a photo opportunity, make more money. All right, Disney obviously do it right. I mean, no matter how stupid you felt driving that, you're still going to take a picture of it, aren't you? Right? Now, I experienced these in Portugal. Has anybody been on one of those golf boards? They are so much fun. And you know, I like to walk and I like to carry. I'm old school, okay? I'm like, throw the clubs on my back. I am not using the golf cart and I am not using a trolley. I'm hoofing it, okay? However, that is so much fun. Takes a little getting used to, but after about 9 holes, you can actually steer it with your body. It's great for your tummy. You know, it's really good for your core. Excuse me. Really good for your core. So that makes the experience more fun. For me, anywhere they have those, I'm going to take that over a golf cart or anything else because I really enjoy it. It actually enhances my experience. Taking a golf cart never enhances my experience unless I'm on a really hilly golf course. And even then, I'll probably walk. But that enhances my experience. There I am at Pine Needles with my good buddy Kelly Miller. And he's got a couple. And this is a very traditional resort. And this is a very traditional resort. Kelly's a traditional guy. He's a member of Pine Valley. He's a member of Seminole. But he's gone out there and put these. And we had a great time on these golf motorbikes. And again, talking about the younger crowd. Talking about the people who are into the digital experience, this is going to appeal to them a whole lot more than your golf cart. This was kind of cool. This was up in Oregon, and there they give what a concept. They gave the customers a choice. What a concept in the golf business, right? You can take a cart, or you can take a surfboard, or you can take the motorbike thingy. That great golf course, by the way, great, great golf course. And you're probably wondering, how do I play all these golf courses? Well, right now I'm on day 189 of a round the world golf trip. I've just taken the year off, and I'm just going around the world playing golf. So I get to find all these amazing things that I can share with you. That was in Europe somewhere, France, I think, or maybe it was, no, might have been Switzerland. This was cool. So I show up at one club. No big deal, right? No big deal, except I show up and I put my name on it. And I mean, they don't do that for everybody. You know, nobody else had balls with a name on it. I go out to the range, come back for the season, and there's, they know I'm a range rat. I love to hit balls. And there's my name. And look at that, it's that piece of paper, right? But you know what? Made me feel good, made me feel special. And of course, I took a picture of it and shared it with the 2 million people I reach on LinkedIn, on Facebook, and other places. Boom, photo. Let's talk about ranges. You'll love this one. About 10 years ago, maybe longer than that, 15 years ago, Nike had a staff program for influencers, right? And I had a Nike contract. I was on the Nike staff. And they want to kit us out. So they take us to this range at Celebration that shows you how in tune they were with the golf market, with water balls to do a club fitting, limited flight floaters to do a club fitting. I knew you'd like that one. Anyway, it was nice to be on the staff. I got free stuff forever. So, water range. Some players, you know, this could enhance their experience. I'm always worried about a water range, about hitting balls and seeing them splash, that it's sending the wrong message to my brain. But water ranges can be fun. This is kind of just a fun idea where you can win prizes for chipping in and stuff. Somewhere in Wisconsin or somewhere. This is a range out in Nevada. Photo worthy. So I got a buddy in England. He owns a range called Swingers and Boomers. Now you guys are all talking about the new high-tech experience, the Top Golf, the back nine, the range stuff, and that's all great. And I love it, all the stuff you're talking about. Totally into it. This guy wasn't quite so technical. He went out and bought 3 Chieftain tanks for $10,000, put them out on his range, and made an extra $90,000 in revenue simply by putting those tanks on his range. Boomers and swingers, 10 grand. That's a low-tech solution, okay? That's a low-tech solution to increasing the entertainment value of your golf. Now, anybody ever played Pine Valley? You played Pine Valley, right? Not? I'll hook you up there. All right, we'll swap. I'll get you on Pine Valley, you get me on Augusta, okay? All right, done deal. Well, it's worth the trip, Mike. So if you go to Pine Valley, I mean, it's the number one golf course in the world for the last 30 years, and it's in a very low-end neighborhood called Clementon, New Jersey. You know, you can rent a 2-bedroom apartment there for about $500. The going rate in the States is probably $2,000. And you go through Clementon, and then you go past this 1950s fun fair with kind of 1950s wooden roller coasters, and you go down this long street, and it says dead end. But don't be discouraged by the sign that's dead end, because it isn't really a dead end. There's this huge hedge, you know, as high as that wall, and there's a hole in the hedge. And you go through the hole, across the railroad track. There's a little guard shack there, like a little English garden shed, painted white and green. And beyond the garden shed is 3 more garden sheds, painted white and green. One of them says police station, one of them says fire station, and one of them says U.S. Post Office. Now, up until last year, Pine Valley was a men-only golf club, and yet had a U.S. post office on their grounds. How is this possible? Pine Valley was built during the Prohibition era in America, where you couldn't buy alcohol. And the founding members of the club, the course was designed by a Philadelphia hotel owner called George Crump, and was finished off by Harry Colt, the famous English architect, upon his death. And back then, they didn't want anybody spoiling their fun. They wanted to drink, they wanted to smoke cigars. And the only way to do that was to become a city. Because once you become a city, the cops from the other cities can't come in. And back in 1919, 1920, whenever it was, you only needed three things to become a city: a police station, a fire station, and a U.S. post office. And so the city of Pine Valley has a fireman, has a postmaster, has a policeman, and is in fact its own city. So that's kind of cool. So you go there, and the clubhouse is old. It's built in 1920s. It's kind of smelly. We always take the eight rooms upstairs. One of my best friends is a member, not me. We take the eight rooms for our group. And communal showers. Obviously, unbelievable golf course. I mean, it's a golf course where, you know, like one, I'm a raider for several different people, Golf Digest and Platinum Clubs of the World and World's Best Golf Destinations. And one of the criteria I always look at is, how many holes do I remember tomorrow? How many holes do I remember a week from now? Like, I just recently played the Crosby, which is a very, very high-end, nice course in San Diego. Played there a week ago. And it was a really nice experience, and I'm really glad I played there. And I can remember maybe four holes. The first time I played Pine Valley, I remembered every single hole. They're so different, so interesting, great topography, just really great golf course. And so I'm fortunate that my best friend is a member, and he frequently allows me to bring guests. So I bring the guests to Pine Valley, world's greatest golf course, go back, have the same caddy year after year after year, same guy at the bar, they treat him well, same guy in the restaurant. Been going there 22 years, the same guys. You know, a few guys retired, but great experience. So I take all these people to Pine Valley. And you know what they talk about? You know what the number one thing they talk about? The turtle soup. The soup. The damn soup. They take them to Pine Valley, they talk about the soup. They have world famous soup there. Turtle soup. You pour a little sherry in, that's the sherry. A lot of people pour a lot of sherry in. And the other thing they talk about, again, communal showers, bunch of guys walking around naked. The shower heads are like this big. Like, remember the old Star Trek, they used to beam people up? You stand in that shower, and it's just like, you're just in this, I don't know, it's nirvana. They talk about the showers. They talk about the showers, and they talk about the soup. Insane, but true. And there's a lot of places in America where they have a dish that signifies the club. Something so special, people talk about it. Now that doesn't look particularly special, does it? You would think you could get that anywhere. That is the famous burger dog. And the story goes that Lake Merced, which is a very famous course in near San Francisco, there was a food truck across the street from the fourth hole. And when the members would get down to the fourth hole, play was being held up while they sent the caddies across the road to get them all a burger dog. So eventually, sometime in the 50s, 60s, they invited the guy to bring the food truck into the club and park it there. And the guy's been there ever since. There he is, the famed burger dog. So what are we doing here? What we got here is all three of things that I'm talking about at once. Number one, the one strategy. They've got something that's so famous, it's been in Golf Digest. The burger dog has been written up in the LA Times. It's been written up in Golf Digest. It is something unique to that club. the one strategy. Number two, it's experiential. Apparently it tastes so friggin' good, people were willing to run across the street off property to go get it. And number three, it's photographable. Okay, that is the, you know, to me that looks pretty disgusting, but I don't like peanut butter.